श्री महेंद्र भाई पटेल, प्रेसिडेंट ऑफिस बेयरर्स एंड मेंबर्स ऑफ द अहमदाबाद मैनेजमेंट एसोसिएशन, श्री पीआर जोशी, श्री राजीव वस्तुपाल, डिस्टिंग्विश्ड सिटीजन्स ऑफ अहमदाबाद, रिप्रेजेंटेटिव्स ऑफ द प्रेस एंड इलेक्ट्रॉनिक मीडिया एंड फ्रेंड्स, आई वेलकम दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू इंटरैक्ट विद द अहमदाबाद मैनेजमेंट एसोसिएशन, the AMA, a fine institution founded almost half a century ago by my good friend, the late Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. Mrinalini Behan is in the audience. And I have been very impressed by reading your annual report and by realizing that this is one of those very special management associations which is actively involved in the processes of public education at all levels, from children up to senior managers. And it reflects, in fact, the efficiency and dynamism of the Gujarati community as a whole. I had come here, I recall, a few years ago to deliver the Vikram Sarabhai Memorial Lecture. And this time, the lecture is in memory of the late Shri Raman Bhai Patel. I met him, in fact, on some occasions earlier. He was a distinguished industrialist, especially in the field of pharmaceuticals. And he was also not only an entrepreneur, but he was an academician and a literateur. And this collection of poems and is certainly a useful contribution to Gujarati literature. May I say, friends, what a pleasure it always is for me to meet with fellow educationists, particularly teachers, because surely teaching is the noblest profession on this planet, because it involves not only the transmission of knowledge, but hopefully of wisdom and of values. Because merely transmission of information now is not enough. That is available on the internet in any case. But the art of teaching lies in weaving into the information avalanche, extracting therefrom the knowledge and then going on to the wisdom. There is a beautiful definition of learning in our scriptures: ya vidya sa vimuktaye. Knowledge is that which liberates us from fear, liberates us from fanaticism, liberates us from ignorance and from the darkness of narrow minds. I had the privilege of being a member of the UNESCO International Commission on Education in the 21st Century. This is a book. It is called Learning the Treasure Within. And I would strongly recommend that this should be studied in some depth. This was a commission set up by UNESCO in the late 90s. It was chaired by Jacques Delors, the eminent European statesman. And there were 15 members, of which I had the privilege of being one. And in this report, we identified what we called the four pillars of learning. And that is where I have derived the title of my lecture today, the four pillars of learning. The title of the report itself is significant: Learning the Treasure Within. In other words, it is ultimately within us that the source of light and inspiration lies. And so this, I think, is a very, if I may say so, a very Indian concept. And the fact that the UNESCO Commission should have chosen this name is significant. And we identified four pillars of learning, and I'm going to speak to you today about those four pillars briefly. The first pillar is learning to know, what we might call the Jnana Yoga. Ano Bhadra Kritavo Yantu Vishwata. Let noble thoughts and ideas come to us from every side. As I said, there is a massive explosion of information now. It is doubling every 5 years. But from this huge ocean of information, we've got to construct knowledge. And from the knowledge, we've got to then move up to wisdom. The Mundaka Upanishad tells us that there are two kinds of knowledge: paravidya or aparavidya, the higher knowledge and the lower knowledge. And therefore, we go from information to the lower knowledge, and from the lower knowledge, ultimately, hopefully, to the higher knowledge. Otherwise, mere technological information is not enough. That can end in disaster. For example, I can give you the example of Atlanta, the great civilization glittering with all the glories of science and technology. We come across the story in the writings of Plato, and one night we are told Atlanta sank below the waves, unable to survive its own technological ingenuity. Or even the Titanic. There again, it was hubris, it was ahankar. We thought we had built the unsinkable ship, which could never be sunk and which was irresistible, little knowing that those icebergs were looming up in the darkness. Therefore, simply technological knowledge is not enough unless it is accompanied also by a deeper understanding. So learning to know involves getting knowledge from wherever it is available, and then interpreting that knowledge in a creative fashion. It also involves the capacity to learn lifelong. One of the concepts put forward in this report is the concept of lifelong learning. The idea that learning finishes either when you pass high school or when you pass your university education and then you go into life, as it were, is no longer valid. The whole of life is a learning experience, from the womb literally all the way to the tomb. Now it is, we heard the story of Abhimanyu, but now it is being proved that even in the womb, the child can respond to certain information or certain vibrations. And then throughout life, one learns. I, for one, try to make it a point to learn something new every day, because you must continue to grow throughout your life. It has rightly been said, people do not grow old. When they stop growing, they become old. So it is a question really of learning throughout life. And learning in a broad fashion. We do not want, we do not want the specialist who has been defined as a person who knows more and more about less and less until he knows everything about nothing. Nor the generalist who knows less and less about more and more until he knows nothing about everything. So we don't want those sort of people. We want people with a balanced mind who are able to take in the specializations, but also to address the broader problems that confront society. Now, it is not important what we learn. Frankly, all the physics, all the chemistry, all the mathematics and history that I learned at school is outdated. The question is, do we develop in our young people the capacity to learn? That, I think, is tremendously important. And I would particularly say, because there are students here as well as teachers, the regular upgradation of skills is very important. If it is true that a student never stops learning, it is also true that a teacher, once you've got your teaching education, your B.Ed. Or your M.Ed., that doesn't mean you can teach for the rest of your life, because the knowledge that you are teaching is out of date in 5 years. So the teachers also have constantly got to upgrade their knowledge. Then only can they continue to be relevant in this rapidly changing society in which we live. So that is the first pillar of learning, what we might call the Jnana Yoga, learning to know. The second pillar that we identified is learning to do, the Karma Yoga. Yoga, karma, sukaushalam, as the Gita says. Unless education teaches us the capacity to do productive activity, it really in some ways becomes meaningless. In India, there is a mismatch between learning to know and learning to do, as a result of which there is massive educated unemployment and a terrible waste, a psychic waste, a spiritual waste, a physical material waste, because lakhs of young people are just bhatkoing without any job, and their education has not equipped them to do any job. And there is this very curious belief in this country that once you are educated, then you can't do a job with your hands. I mean, that's ridiculous. I think it was Gardner who, one of his books says that a society that honors philosophy because it considers it to be a noble profession, and looks down on plumbing because it considers it to be a lowly profession, will get the worst of both worlds. Neither its theories nor its pipes will hold water. So this is the thing. Unfortunately, what we have done is we have made our many young people unemployable. The plus two theory that we adopted has failed. The whole point of plus two was, I remember the Radhakrishnan report, that after the 10th, many young people would be siphoned off into one of these three streams. That has not happened. People go on to plus two, then they drift on to college because there's nothing better to do. So I think this is really the great weakness of our educational system. Our IITs are as good as any in the world. The products of our IIT is the top. But where are the ITIs? Where are the industrial training institutes? We need a whole network of thousands and thousands of ITIs. We can put a rocket into outer space, but you cannot get anybody to repair your television or to repair your car. Because there is not a proper linkage between learning to know and learning to do. And now, particularly with innovative technologies, with distance education and so on, it is very important that we teach our young people skills that they can use in their life. And learning to do, of course, let me add, involves a positive value system. The work must be shuchir daksha, as the Gita says, to aim at excellence. And work itself can become a powerful methodology of inner growth and spiritual awakening. Therefore, this concept of learning to do is the second pillar upon which the structure of education must rest. The third pillar, and I'm going to spend some time on this one, this is learning to live together. Sahana vavatu, sahana ubhunuktu, sahaviryam karvavahi, tejasvi navadhitamastu, ma vidvishavahi. May we think together, may we act together, may we achieve together, may there be no hatred between us. That is the essence of what we need in a global society and what we need in our own country. We have the great concepts. If you have been to Parliament House, on the very first gate, there is a beautiful shloka, Ayam Nija Paroveti Gana Naam Lagu Chetasam Udar Charita Naamatu Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Vasudeva Kutumbakam, the world is a family. This was an idea which our ancients had thousands of years ago. Long before the internet and long before satellite technology, which has made this a reality now. And yet, our mindsets are still stuck in the pre-global societies. We have not learned to live together. And learning to live together is, to my mind, the most important thing if we are going to survive in this highly competitive world. And so this was identified as learning to live together. And learning to live together involves the transmission of a positive value system. And I'm going to briefly touch on five dimensions of the value system that are required. There are, first of all, family values. We can't neglect family values. If values are not taught in the family, then it is difficult to expect them to be accessed outside the family. For example, consideration for elders, solidarity, helpfulness. With the breakup of the joint family now and the emergence of the nuclear family, elderly people are getting more and more vulnerable. They are often left to their own devices. This is not something new, by the way. Shankaracharya, thousands of years ago, has a shloka, Yavat vitto parjana sakta tavat nijaparivaro rakta. Pachadhavati jarajar dehe vartam prichhati kopi nage. That when you have a lot of money, when you are there, everybody says, Dadaji, aap kaise hain, Bapuji, aap kaise hain. And once you get old and bhatkuing, nobody bothers about you. So this was apparently true even in the time of Shankaracharya. It's more true now. And therefore, I think the family values are important. And our elders also must learn to be less possessive. In this country, we seem to feel that we can run out the lives of our children. We can't. As Khalil Gibran says, your children come through you, but they do not belong to you. They come with their own karma. They come with their own consciousness. And therefore, don't worry about the telephone. You keep looking at me. Telephone bajta rehta hai. Aap uski chinta na kare. Meri aur drishti rakhi. So, this is very important. Family values are of the essence. And family values involve two sets. One is the parent-child relationship, and the other is the husband-wife relationship. And both of them have to be balanced. If the youngsters are expected to show consideration, the elders must also be less possessive. And the husband and wife relationship, of course, the old custom of the woman walking three footsteps behind the husband is ridiculous, and if I may say so, equally ridiculous is the Western custom of the woman walking three paces ahead. So what you really need is for them to walk side by side, the Ardhangini, the co-sharer in the adventure of life. So these relationships have got to be properly balanced. These are family values which have got to be transmitted. Then there are societal values. Cleanliness, punctuality, teamwork. I mean, these may appear very simple, and I'm very impressed that here in Gujarat, your lecture started on time, because otherwise in Delhi, I'm notorious for my punctuality. Let me tell you, when I became minister first, I went to a place, I got there on the dot, neither the organizer nor the audience was there. So I left my card and I came away. Now everybody knows pe Karan Singh ko bulao to wo time pe pahunch jate hain. So this is something, you know, we live in anadi ananta kal hakriti gachyati ayu, kya farak padta aadha ghanta baad mein pahunch jayenge, is not good enough. We've got to be meticulous about our activities. Cleanliness. Individually we are very clean. We bathe in Ekadashi, and we bathe on Purnima, and we bathe in the Kumbh, and we bathe here and we bathe there, but collectively we are the biggest clutter bugs in the world. Jitna kachara hamare desh mein paida hota aur kahin paida nahi hota. And we have this most objectionable system of safai karmchari. So you throw your kachara out onto the road and somebody else will pick it up. In the West, you don't do that. You can be a millionaire, but if it snows, you and your wife get out and you shovel the snow away from your walk. You don't have any safai karmcharis coming and clearing your house there. Cleanliness. I once said in Parliament that if we can ensure clean toilets in India, we will have solved half our problem. The only clean toilet I've seen in many years is the one I just saw in this institution. Maybe it was newly built. But otherwise, it's impossible to... it's impossible to get a clean toilet in this country. And so cleanliness, punctuality... and in societal values, I don't want to embarrass the audience, but how many of you know that apart from fundamental rights, there is a section of fundamental duties in our constitution? Do you know that? Does anybody teach them? Does anybody here know how many duties they are? I don't think so. I don't want you to raise your hands because I'm not a school teacher. I don't want to embarrass you. But I would be very surprised if there are more than half a dozen people, even in this audience, who know what the fundamental duties are. There are 10 fundamental duties in part 4A of the Indian Constitution. I was on the drafting committee with Sardar Swaran Singh. Nobody is worried in this country about duties. Everybody clamors for their rights, whether it is truck owners, or whether it is bank employees, or whether it is government employees, give us more, give us more, give us more. Na vitte na tarpaniyo manushya, as the Upanishad say. But what about your duties? What about your responsibilities? Does anybody ever stress that? Do we teach that to our younger generation? So therefore, you cannot have it only one way. You cannot have all take, take and no give. So these are the sort of societal values which we have got to transmit from generation to generation, and particularly our teachers must imbibe them. So we have family values, you have societal values, you have interfaith values. Most important, we've had terrible, terrible examples of interfaith conflict in this country quite recently. And this is against all the tenets. I mean, the Rig Veda teaches us Ekam Sat Vipraha Bahudha Vadanti. The truth is one, the wise call it by many names. There are many ways, multiple paths to the divine. We must accept this. No one religion has a monopoly of divine contact. No one can claim a monopoly of divine contact. Certainly you can say that my path is the best for me, but I cannot therefore say, because you do not follow my path, therefore I will kill you, or I will prosecute you or persecute you. That is not acceptable. So this interfaith understanding, Sarva Dharma Samabhava, is something that is built not only into our constitution, it is also built into our ancient cultural tradition. The Mundaka Upanishad, for example, Yatha Nadya Sandhyamana Samudre Astam Gachanti Namurupe Vihaya, Tatha Vidwan Namurupat Vimuktaha, Parat Param Purushom Upaiti Divyam. As streams and rivulets arise in different parts of the world but finally flow into the same ocean, so do all the religions and all the paths and all the sampradayas arise in different places, but ultimately they cannot be different divinities. This has to be taught. The interfaith movement has to be strengthened. I have been part of this movement for the last 30 years. It began in 1893 with the first Parliament of World Religions in Chicago. And just this month, last month in July, the fourth Parliament was held in Barcelona, Spain. And the whole of the 20th century, a number of interfaith organizations came into being. I happened to be chairman of one of them called the Temple of Understanding. A simple book we have published, Unity in Diversity, which is thoughts of the world's great religions in different categories and different subjects. If even a book like this finds its way to every student, it will help them understand better how all the different religions, they may be very different in their theology, but in their actual approach to problems, there's a great deal of commonality. Unfortunately, religion has become a divisive force. Ultimately, what is religion but a strengthening of the inner consciousness? Allama Iqbal has a beautiful shair, Khudi ko kar buland itna ke har takdeer se pehle Khuda bande se khud puche bata teri raza kya hai. What better definition of religion or of yoga can there be than that? And yet, even down to this very day, even as I speak to you today, religion is being used as an instrument to divide people, to divide societies, to stoke the fires of hatred and fanaticism. And therefore, interfaith values are of the essence if we are going to live in a harmonious society. Fourthly, there are environmental values. I went today to the Center for Environmental Education. Karthike is here. Excellent center. The environment is deteriorating. Thousands of species are disappearing. Millions of acres of forests are disappearing every year. Global warming is taking place in a big way. You saw a film called Day After Tomorrow, how suddenly the weather can change and can destroy the planet. And yet we are blissfully unaware of this. Our teachers, our students must be aware of environmental values. There must be planting of saplings, there must be nature walks, there must be visit to parks and zoos and so on. These are environmental values. And finally, values for a global society. We must realize that although we are Indians, India is not an end in itself. India is part of a global society. Ultimately, the world is one unit. You cannot divide it artificially into 200 different sovereignties. Fair enough, for certain purposes you can do that. But in the final analysis, the world is a single unit, and therefore we must teach that to our children. Global values, that we are part of a larger global community. Let us begin with SAARC, which is our own South Asia region. And then we go on. Look at the way the European Union has developed. It is an astounding thing, the European Union, they have got over hatreds and animosities of 500, 600 years. How many wars were fought in Europe? We learnt all about it in our history books. The 30 Years' War and the 100 Years' War, and the Wars of the Roses, the Napoleonic Wars, the First World War, millions upon millions slaughtered in the battlefields of Europe. And today you can travel from Poland to Portugal and from Norway to Greece without a passport. It's become one union. We went there earlier this year, my wife and I. The mark has disappeared, the franc has disappeared, the shilling has disappeared. Everybody has moved on to a common currency. If they can do it, why can't we do it? Germany and France were enemies for 500 years. We have only been enemy for 50 years with Pakistan. And even there, as Shakil Badayuni says, har cheez nahi hai markaz par, ik zarra idhar, ik zarra udhar. Nafrat se na dekho dushman ko, shayad wo mohabbat kar baithe. And so, these are global values. So I have delineated for you five values, five sets of values. Family values, societal values, interfaith values, environmental values, global values, which all of them are required for the third pillar of learning, which is learning to live together. The first pillar was learning to know. The second pillar was learning to do. The third pillar was learning to live together. And the fourth, and mind you, all these four pillars are essential. Without one pillar, the structure will collapse. The fourth pillar is learning to be. It's a very interesting concept, learning to be. What are we? What is our inner strength? Are we just skimming across life without once diving into the depths of our consciousness? Do we realize that there lies within us the spark that can be fanned into the blazing fire of spiritual realization? Hiranamaye pare koshe virijam brahma nishkalam tat shubhram jyotisham jyoti satat atma vidho vidhu. That's what the Upanishad says. Vedaham etam purusham mahantam aditya varanam tamasaparastha. I have seen that great being shining like a thousand suns beyond the darkness. That is within us. Francis Thompson has a marvelous poem. Not where the wheeling systems darken and our benumbed conceiving soars, the drift of pinions would we hearken beats in our own clay shuttered doors. The angels keep their ancient places. Turn but a stone and start a wing. Tis ye, tis your estranged faces that miss the many splendid thing. The many splendid light the Atman. What the Bible calls the light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world. What the Sufis call the Noor-e-Elahi. That light is within us. Are we going to develop that? When we say learning to be, it means we must learn to fulfill our inner potential. We must remember we are engaged in a fascinating adventure of consciousness. Life is a unique opportunity. Young people particularly must realize that. Bernard Shaw once said, youth is a wonderful thing. What a pity it is wasted on the young. Meaning thereby that many young people don't realize that they are going through, they are growing up, life is going passing through your hands. Before you realize it, you're middle-aged and you're old. So we've got to constantly look within, find ourselves, find our inner being. So learning to know, learning to do, learning to live together, learning to be, these are four pillars upon which the structure of a creative educational system can be built. And let me end by saying the responsibility for our teachers and our educationists is very great. We have to nurture future generations. We have to nurture our country. We have to nurture planet Earth. The most beautiful photograph ever taken is the photograph of planet Earth taken from outer space. You remember that NASA photograph? That should hang in every classroom. That shows our planet as it really is, a tiny speck of light and life against the unending vastnesses of eternity. This is the mother that has nurtured consciousness up from the slime of the primeval ocean billions of years ago to where we are today. We are the first generation to have seen that photograph. No prophet, no avatar, nobody saw that before. It is like looking at a mirror for the first time. That is the earth we must. It's a common earth. It is Bhavani Vasundhara. Sri Aurobindo talked about Bhavani Bharati. I suggest we now have to move from Bhavani Bharati to Bhavani Vasundhara. The earth itself is a goddess. We have to nurture her. And it is only if all of us make our contribution to building and nurturing this earth that we will be able to create a sane and harmonious global society. Thank you.